In this video, we're going to be talking about two movies that directors need to know that revolve around characters living in New York City who experience a great deal of loneliness. We're Coffee with Aliens at the Movies, a film literacy channel and review channel. My name is Robert Bellissimo. I'm an actor and acting teacher.
I'm Steve Chambers. I'm an actor and a writer.
And if this is your first time here, please consider subscribing to our channel by clicking the red watermark in the bottom right of your screen. So the first film we're going to be looking at today is Midnight Cowboy from 1969 with John Voight and Dustin Hoffman, which Steve has picked today. So Steve, what is it that directors can take from this film?
One, you have these amazing performances by John Voight and Dustin Hoffman. And I know that's like, well, yeah, no kidding, everyone. No, but they're really amazing. Like,
oh yeah,
watching Dustin Hoffman, and then I suddenly flashed to Tootsie and The Graduate, and I'm like, wow. Anyway,
yeah,
super good. And it's this very, 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 at its core, tender love story about two men. And I know there's been writing about it, like, well, are we saying that they're gay? And, you know, who cares? It really doesn't matter. It's just a love story. It's two men that meet each other, two characters that are super, super lonely. Why I might have thought it was an upbeat ending at the end is, yeah, John Voight's character does say, you know, I'm not cut out for this hustling. Maybe I'll get a job outdoors. Yeah, that's what I'll do. There's a bit of hope. But our Dustin Hoffman character, Ratso, has died. And it's bleak. But on the other hand,
it's two sides of the coin, right?
Like, it is. It's my time in New York, he represents the dark, the cold, the struggle is dead. I'm going this way. And what I still take from it is John Voight is going to live his dream. He made it to Miami.
Yeah.
He didn't get out of the bus. I think it was more interesting in making it look like, and I mean this in the best possible way, a rock video. And it does. I mean, there are weird shots and the cutting back and forth to TV show clips and then, you know, all over the place, the Joe Buck's flashbacks and black and white. And it's surreal. I think it's wonderful.
But it's interesting because I never thought of it that way, that yes, we have the gritty New York and Schlesinger. Schlesinger, I can't even say that. Went to New York to because, you know, he was British, to really look at what it looks like and he wanted it to have that grittiness. Yeah. But it's interesting because, as you say, there is this other side of the style that is this 60s.
It's very colorful and it's very quick. The edits are quick. He doesn't hold on anything.
The whole Andy Warhol party and some of the music and even the dream sequences are very upbeat. But wouldn't you say that the reason for that sort of secondary style is because these guys want to get out of the
greediness
that they want to go out?
Absolutely. I think you nailed it. So I think three things. One, Schlesinger doing his research, going to New York looking for the grittiness. It's still there, don't get me wrong. It's not like it's shot on the back lot of a studio. It doesn't look like Singing in the Rain. Like, we're on 42nd Street in 1969, don't get me wrong. He found, that's a real hotel, it's demolished now, that Voight initially stays in. That is a seedy place on Broadway, and Broadway back then is not what you think it is now. And it was dangerous, and there were a lot of prostitutes and hustlers and the pickpockets, whatever. And he did find all the locations that, like a documentarian would. But then, once he found them, and he put John Voight on the street with these guys, smoking cigarettes and looking at men, like, he shot, on the day, he shot it like a documentarian. In post-production, in the editing, why he did that, I don't know, but it could be, to your point, the motive behind that could be just a great representation of these two, again, bleak characters looking for a way out. Oh, when Hoffman sends John Voight to a hotel and he waits outside in the snow, what's he picturing? He's got that nice music by John Barry Florida sunshine, and he's picturing himself. His ultimate dream is John Voight running on the beach while Hoffman cooks for the ladies. And
doing bingo.
That's right. He's calling out bingo. Yes. And everyone's called Rico.
Yeah.
And so we know their fantasy life is alive and well, as it needs to be. And so, yes, maybe the way it was, okay, I hesitate to say shot, but maybe the way it was finally edited and colored and presented with the music was a representation of that fantasy.
Do you think then that filmmakers, what they can take from this also is, to embrace complexities with, if the characters are very complex and the themes are not just one theme, then also bring that out with the visuals and music?
100%. I think no human being sits in one thing all the time. If you're doing a film about people living, oh my God, they can't be one note, right? They got to change.
Right.
And if they're going to change, why the hell would I want to see it shot in one way with one type of score? And it, okay, so what? You're going to introduce me to Joe Buck then, by that rationale, is happy at the beginning. Woo-hoo! He's going to stay like that the entire film, and I'm going to have cowboy music the whole time? Like, ugh. And what? And then by contrast, Hoffman's just going to be listening to, like, I don't know, this creepy horror violin. Misery. No, because he wants to escape that. Buck is learning stuff too, right?
Right.
He immediately has his dreams quashed. He's gonna change. And if it wasn't for Hoffman, shit was getting dark.
And all these things you're discussing are also subtle. It doesn't really elevate it to such a...
No, you don't notice it consciously.
Because it's really subtle to the relationship and what's happening.
100%.
The two men. Yeah, that's a really good point. Yeah. I hadn't thought of it that the contrasting styles, because when I think of it, I think of greedy New York and the loneliness and the love story.
Yeah,
that's true.
And it is.
Their fantasies, he does really reflect their fantasies and their nightmares with
their
different styles. Yeah, that is 100%. Really, I don't know why that didn't dawn on me until you said it. Yeah, very, very cool. So the other film we're discussing, which is my pick for today, is Francis Ha, which was written and directed by Noah Baumbach. And actually Greta Gerwig co-wrote the script with Noah Baumbach, and she's the lead in it, who plays Francis. It's a coming of age story, a woman growing into her late 20s, right before women are having children and getting married and so on and so forth. So the fact that she lives with this woman who's her best friend, and they're inseparable, and they're like kids, like they have a very kid-like relationship, like they're like play fight, their humor is very kid-like. But her friend, Francis's friend, has more of her life together. As opposed to, she has a better job, she's making more money, whereas Frances is, she works for a dance company, she's a dancer as an apprentice, and she's not getting paid very much, so she's always broke. The heart of it is about loneliness, and Noah Baumbach uses often upbeat, French New Wave music, particularly early on, because there is a romanticism around being young and around being broke and around living in New York and working as an artist and working for a dance company. The film really shows the beauty of youth and the innocence of youth, but at the same time that, okay, what's next? And then as she cannot face growing up, she doesn't really know how to, because she's emotionally immature. So then as her friend moves out with her, she then is mingling with different people, and she can't fit in everywhere. I love the confusion of it. We've discussed that before. Like, often in conventional films, characters will face a problem, but then have a confident way of going about trying to get past the obstacles or what have you. But she doesn't know what to do. She finds herself... living with these guys, and then she loses her job, and she, it's Christmas, she goes home, and she now has no job and no place to live, and she doesn't tell anybody. And I can relate to that, and that's a very lonely feeling of, God, something's going on, and I'm scared to tell anyone, because I'm going to be judged, or I'm going to have to give up my dream of being a dancer and go back home. And, you know, she could do that. She could just go back home and live with her parents. But as someone who's, you know, and you know, Steve, like being in the arts, like when you do that, it's like, it's can lead to a depression. It's like game over.
Yes.
You know,
in a lot of ways. Yes.
So the film really is, and Sarah Pauly did an interview with Greta Gerwig.
I saw that.
That people... as much as it feels like a really upbeat comedic film, it is really lonely. And I've seen this maybe four or five times, and that really hooked in for me when I just recently watched it yesterday, thinking like, ooh, yeah, like it's like no one's trying to be dramatic, no one's trying to be funny.
Mm.
Yet it is all those things. And I think what directors can really learn from it is that Noah Baumbach and Greta Gerwig, they just wrote this truthfully. They wrote, okay, what are young people like this like? Okay, they would talk, okay, clearly they knew these people and wrote down what they may talk about. And it's no one's going for a joke. No one's going for a sad line or this has to be thematically correct. It's just done in a very truthful way. And I think that's why it plays to the drama of it. It plays to the sadness of it and the humor of it. I mean, and I love Greta Gerwig in this movie. And of course, in the end, she matures and she makes choices that in the end work better for her and actually get rid of certain pride she had about taking on an office job with a dance company.
Right.
So she takes it, and then she's able to still choreograph and do her own work and stuff like that. So it's very, it doesn't have the bleakness of Midnight Cowboy, especially with Ratso. But it does revolve around these themes of loneliness in New York City, not knowing what to do. I think also Noah Baumbach, again, why we say being a film buff is so important. He also was inspired. The reason it's black and white is because he was very inspired by the early work of Godard, Truffaut, which is about young people, the black and white movies, the cigarettes, the smoke, the dancing. And he took those elements, and that's why he wanted it to be black and white.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting.
The other thing I wanted to mention that directors can really learn from this, and this really goes for male directors, and I have to be careful with the way I say this because I don't want to sound, politically speak to social politics. So I may edit this, but I'll say it for now. I'll say it anyways.
Absolutely.
I think men really need to get more interested in women, in what women are like.
Let me stop you right now. Don't edit this out. This will be good. Sorry.
Go. Yeah.
This, I thought you were going to say something.
I can already see the comments. Here we go. Here comes the left wing.
That's right.
So, you know, but it's true. I think, and if you, and look at the partnerships, again, film history, look at the partnerships between Monica Vitti and Antonioni. Look at the work that came from that. Look at the work that came from Cassavetes and Jenna Rollins. I'm not saying, hey guys, you have to do this. I mean, if what you know and what you need to express is something from you and something from you and your best friend who's a male or whatever, then go with it. But I think if you want to evolve, I think really you know, women are really interesting. Women are really fascinating and different. And I think that's what's so interesting. Like there's a scene in Frances Ha where the two women are talking about like bad sex they've had, you know? And I just thought, oh, I've never heard women talk like that in a movie. And again, Greta Gerwig is the co-writer on this,
right.
Noah Baumbach really wanted to make it because he really liked working with her in his last film, Greenberg, right? So she is
I remember Greenberg.
That's right. And she's very much a part of this, and it came from his interest in her as an actor and as a writer. And I've never seen anything like that. So, of course, as much as we need more female directors, which is something that is really more and more is a push for that, and, of course, the right choice, I think men at the same time need to not just have the women in their films be reacting off the men's story or be the sexual pursuit or what have you. Not that that always is the case, but it is all off the case a lot.
Yeah. Don't just write what you know.
It's just consciousness, right? It's just, there's more to paint from in that palette, right? Than the four colors you're using. There's a fifth, there's a sixth.
Yes, that's
all I'm saying. I don't want people to think you've got to do this because it's the politically correct thing to do.
I'm 100%
just saying because it's going
to
make you
better. Just be open to it. Just be open to it.
That's totally. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. We hope that you picked up some filmmaking tips along your journey. If you're an aspiring director, an aspiring writer, or already a director and already a writer, and films that you can take a look at to inspire you in your different projects or things that you hadn't thought of before that you can explore. If you haven't already done so, please hit the subscribe button. It's just, you'll see the Coffee with Aliens just above the right of my head right now. Hit the subscribe button and we will see you next time.